Joined tonight by the chicken tender bandit, Joe Wisniewski.
Hi.
And the deputy mayor of parts unknown, Mark Gilger. This is Mise en Game Live, and tonight we are going to crown the greatest cutscene of the 2000s with help from you. So thank you for coming out. It's a democracy here at MAGFest. So what is Mise en Game? Mise en Game is the YouTube show dedicated to examining some of gaming's most iconic cutscenes from a filmmaking perspective. Why would we do this with our free time? Well, as media professionals, from journalists to filmmakers, we look at cutscenes and we say, well, these are essentially movies, so are they made well? Do they follow the rules of narrative and visual storytelling to give you an engaging experience? Some do, and are awesome. Some don't, and really suck. And we like parsing through all of this to just take a closer look at what we get in our entertainment.
What makes a good cutscene, Tom?
Makes a good cutscene, in my opinion, the opinion of the show. A good cutscene is a visually driven segment, either in-engine or pre-rendered, that takes control away from the player in order to drive the game narrative forward with emphasis on story structure or character development that is not handled by player choice. It's about you experiencing the narrative as the designers or the directors of the games intended it.
Why the 2000s?
Why the 2000s? That's a great question, Joe. Thank you for asking me that. Well, from 2000 to 2009, it's an interesting period in gaming history. Three console generations were born, lived, and died. We saw some of the best games across some of the best consoles, from PS1 and 64 Dreamcast, all the way up to the Wii 360 and PS3. The decade showcased gaming's growing capabilities to tell deeper, more fulfilling stories, and the advances in technology allowed them to basically up the production value budget to match the spectacle and grandeur of modern Hollywood films, and the faster turnaround time allowed game developers to keep up with modern trends in other forms of media. Something that we have to just acknowledge right away is the faster development time allowed the gaming industry to keep up with the grim, gritty era that we saw in a lot of modern films, from things like Batman Begins. We were a bunch of downers in the 2000s, and all of our art reflected that, and you'll see some of that here tonight. So, we pulled the internet, the most reliable source of information on the planet, with no shenanigans whatsoever, and from Reddit, Twitter, and Facebook, we got a great collection of what some people consider to be the greatest cutscenes of all time. And we put those together, and we parsed through them, and we have a final four. So what we're going to do tonight is we're going to screen the final four candidates, we're going to talk about them, and during each round, one member of the audience we're going to invite up here to be the voice of the people, the second opinion, either for or against the choice. We're going to parse it out, discourse it, and at the end, based on applause-o-meter, we're going to have the best cutscene of the decade. And this handsome certificate is going to be FedExed to the developer of said cutscene, and they will accept it.
With a picture of everybody that picked.
Yes, and we're going to take a nice, lovely group picture so that they know who sent this creepy piece of paper to them. They're going to love it. All right. So, with that in mind, we're going to get things rolling. Got to check our cheat sheet here for a second. But just to get quick biases out of the way, Joe, Mark, what are your favorite games of the 2000s? What are some things that you probably had some input into this? What really inspired you during the decade?
Obviously, we had to pick a Metal Gear game for cutscenes, best cutscenes. I mean, when you think of cutscenes, you know,
Kojima all the way.
Yeah.
He's the best. Yeah, he's the best director accidentally working in games.
And we tried to only pick one from each franchise. We didn't want to pick.
Didn't want to overload it. Yeah, right, so. Right. And it was tough. What about you, Joe?
From the 2000s, yeah. Madden.
Yeah, the cutscenes of Madden are really, really inspiring.
No, but in all seriousness, from the 2000s, my favorite game would probably be Gears of War 2.
Okay.
And, yeah.
Okay. That's just it.
Hey.
Nothing more.
Panel. No, I don't know. I just feel it's has a lot of great cutscenes and great storytelling techniques, even if you have to look past the overly muscular brute guys that would never exist in modern day.
The refrigerators carrying guns, yes, yes.
Pretty much.
Beautiful, beautiful moments in those games, though, absolutely. So, with that in mind, we want to roll a quick highlight reel where we're going to give credit where it's due to the games that did not make the final four, because there were a lot of great ones.
But
so.
They're frequently mentioned on the forums.
Frequently mentioned.
As many
yep.
as we can.
Basically, everything that's in this had at least more than like at least two. Hey, include this. So we wanted to give them their quick spotlight. So that's extra background. Here you go. Enjoy.
Sit, would you kindly? Stand, would you kindly?
Mary?
Thank you. Thank you.
James. Please. Please do something for me. Go on with your life.
Hey, Maestro. Don't you think that's a little bit too dramatic? Can you give me something with a bit more of a beat?
People love that derpy smile.
Oh no.
Spoiler alert.
Spoiler.
Yes, oh, spoiler alert for games that are almost a decade old, by the way.
All right.
It's not from the time period. All right, so our first selection, as was just noticed, is going to be from Metal Gear Solid 3 from 2005, specifically the final moment where Naked Snake has to assassinate his mother figure slash mentor, the boss, in order to stop a nuclear war from breaking out between the United States and the USSR. It's the culmination of Snake's journey. He's wrestling with a lot of conflict, duty versus the emotional relationship he feels with one of the few people he's ever had a deep connection with in his life. So let's see how that plays out.
It's our
and Snake.
Okay, so
guys,
what are your thoughts on our first selection in terms of being up there as the greatest of the decade? Any thoughts that come to mind right off the bat?
It was a tough choice. We wanted to pick something from Metal Gear. Mm. It took us a while to figure out which one we wanted to pick.
There's too many of them, first of all.
But with overall to the franchise, how big of a moment that we felt this was, that was kind of a deciding factor. And obviously,
right.
It's a great scene, too. So.
Yeah, narratively, Big Boss is hell. He looms large over the series as he's described frequently as the perfect soldier. And in this moment, it's his duty as a soldier versus the only person he's ever had a real connection with. And in choosing to follow his orders, he kind of cements his reputation and he goes from being a normal man, a normal soldier, to Big Boss. So symbolically and in terms of the narrative scope of the Metal Gear series, this moment really matters.
It was sad.
Yeah. Man tears. I felt some man tears during that. Yeah. I really liked the cinematography throughout it as well. In the moment where they're having their last words together, there's a handheld kind of camera effect where it's like Kojima wanted to get right up and like, you know, it's a very personal, intimate moment, so he wanted the camera to be right there on them. And once he shoots her, everything becomes stable. The shots still pan and tilt, but they're not shaking anymore, it's all centered, and it's kind of like Snake's kind of found a messed up stability in a way because he's let her go. So I thought that was interesting. Kojima's a huge movie buff, so it's no surprise he knows how to frame his shots and choose what and go with what he's doing. Even when it's at his most bonkers, you know, you have the very on the nose but still emotionally effective white flowers turning red effect there. He just knows how to tell a good story visually. So, you want to open it up for second opinions? See how
Wants to tell us how they felt when they played the game?
Yes, we're going to open it up for second opinions. Anyone from the audience who wants to tell us that we're wrong for having this up here, come up. Also, everyone who votes tonight is going to get one random goodie from the swag bag, because voting's important, but voting only really matters when you're bribed to do it. So we've got some bribes. Mark's going to handle the swag bag. So anyone interested in telling us what they think about this entry, this nominee?
Come
yes.
on up.
Yeah. Thank Let's you. Give a round of applause, everybody. Come on. Pass that microphone. Oh, she got my mic. There you go. Hi, how you doing?
Yeah, we didn't sound
Hi. Do I talk into this?
Yeah, you talk right into the mic. Hi. How you doing? What's your name?
Anna.
Thank you so much for coming up, Anna.
Yeah, no problem. So I've seen this a couple of times, and it's interesting that only watching this time that I noticed that there's a wind effect going on, but the wind isn't coming from anywhere. It's radiating from where Snake and Boss are.
Mm-hmm.
And I like the ripple effect that it's coming out, and I thought that was really interesting what Kojima did there, because basically visualizing a decision that has to be made, and how that one decision in that one moment, how it always starts off as a drop, very small, like it's one bullet, and that is going to radiate out. So I thought that that was very nice symbolism.
It is. That's a very good point.
Yeah. Yeah.
Give Anna a round of applause. Say, hold on.
Ask her if she thinks it should be on this list.
We're good. Do you think it should be on this list, though? Yes, no?
Oh, hell yeah.
Hell yeah? Okay. Hang on. Okay, so thank you for coming up. We're going to give you what we got.
Here we go.
There we go. We've got, hold it up for everybody. Final Fantasy, The Spirits Within. Because this is a show about video games and film, so the prizes have to be appropriate.
We only got the finest.
The finest. Thank you for coming up.
What's next?
Guess I got 3 free movies then. All right, so we're going to move on.
Number two.
Joe, do you want to introduce number two? As I know you were a big fan of this choice. Do you want to talk about how we came to this choice, though? Because this was a hard one with the next franchise that this represents.
We're
going to introduce it.
So we don't spoil it.
All right, well, the next video we have on our top four is from Warcraft 3. There we go.
Yeah,
it is when Arthas returns from Northrend and confronts his father in Lordaeron. And we're going to see how things turn out, and then we'll talk about it a little bit after that.
There we go.
Thank you.
shall fall. And from the ashes shall arise a new order that will shake the very foundations of the world.
All right, so Joe, in terms of the scope of Warcraft's narrative, let's lay this down. Why is this moment so noteworthy?
I thought this was probably the biggest, like, impactful cutscene in the game, because from the beginning of the game, you're introduced as Arthas as, like, you know, the blonde, good-looking hero that's going to save the day. And then as you get to know the character, this is, like, the turning point that turns him from full, like, from any good that he has left into, like, the Lich King, pretty much. And I feel like it does a good, the cinematography does a really good job of, like, hiding Arthas's, like, face and, like, showing him, like, kind of above the king and kind of foreshadowing things, and shows a lot of emphasis on Frostborn and the other thing.
Yeah, the costume design, because at that point, in taking the armor and the sword, he's more or less begun to accept his destiny as the Lich King.
Yeah.
Yeah. I also like that they don't go over the... They could have really gone over the top with the violence of showing him killing his father, but they do it in shadows just to... I think it just kind of keeps the impact on, oh, this dude's killing his dad, and we don't have to see, like... Not that I would shy away from gore. I just think in this moment, it kind of helps the, you know, helps sell the, like, the emotion of the moment.
Yeah, I think less is better in this scene.
Yeah.
No, I just... Yeah, and the crown falling at the end there... and. Very symbolic.
Yeah, very,
very symbolic.
Very common fall from grace trope. Yeah. Been used in a lot of other popular media. Kind of like a much better version of Anakin Skywalker.
Yeah.
Because it's not the prequels.
Better acting.
Better acting, yeah. Yeah, the Warcraft series was tough. We had a lot of really iconic moments picked. The Wrathgate was put forward. The death of Grom Hellscream. What else was in there? I think there was one other two.
Well, there were ones that were picked, but they didn't fit the timeline criteria.
Okay.
From the newer expansion, so.
This was a popular pick.
Right, yeah.
This was one of the more popular ones, too, so I didn't have any gripe with it being on the list, so.
A lot of love for Warcraft, though, yeah. So we wanted to make sure it got on this list. All right, so we need a second opinion. Are we right or wrong?
Right in the front. First hand up.
He won us.
Lay it on us.
Good job being speedy there. How you doing?
Hey, what's your name?
Hey. What's
your name?
Luis.
Luis.
Welcome, right. Luis. Thanks for coming.
Thanks for having me.
Give Luis a hand, yeah. Everybody.
Let's give it up for Luis. Right.
So, I'm going to have to say that I disagree.
Oh, yeah. Dissension. There we go.
Because even though Warcraft 3 is like the most well-known one, most of the Warcraft series happens in the 90s anyway. Like, you know, not chronologically, but the games. I would say what should probably take its place is Shadow of the Colossus. Just because... Like you said, with Warcraft 3, with this scene, it's very tropey. It's like something you expect. It's the Anakin Skywalker, he comes and kills his father. But Shadow of the Colossus, if anyone hasn't played it, and spoilers, I'm sorry, you're actually the bad guy in the end, but you didn't know it. And so it's just that gut-wrenching kind of like twist. I feel like that's a lot stronger than, you know.
Is there a particular scene at the end? Or that,
just the ending
cutscene. I didn't play it.
So. Yeah, okay, where you die.
Okay.
So, yeah. Okay. So
the horse bug. Oh, the horse part always bugs me a little more than the actual end, though. I can never get over that.
I would still take that over that.
Oh yeah, that's true.
So.
Okay. No. Hey.
Thank
yeah.
you.
Hey. Thanks,
you are
Louise.
Entitled to your opinion, because this is MAGFest democracy in action. So
yes,
thanks for coming up. But we got let's get some swag bag goodies out for Luis. Give Luis a hand, everybody.
Random.
Well, we got.
Another,
okay.
Another fine video game.
Show that up for everyone. Unrated. Hitman Unrated.
The original.
Oh, we didn't ID him. It's unrated. Oh, mm. Oh man. Oh, well. Yes. Okay, so, we're going to break up the nominees real quick because there are some other cutscenes that we have to showcase. For every good cutscene we got this decade, we got some awful pieces of trash. And everyone likes ragging on stuff, so we're going to take a little bit of a moment to rag on the worst cutscenes of the decade. Spoilers for terrible games.
Some good games.
I should have been the one to fill your dark soul with light.
Take nappy time with you, okay?
Leave my mama alone, you bad man. I won't let you take Mama Peach away.
Mama? Mama Peach? I'm your mama?
Are you a vampire hunter?
I am. If you're here, you must be one as well.
Uh-huh. They're huge.
Will you stop? These things only get in the way.
I'm the Lightbringer! I'm the fucking universe!
Sonic, come back. To me. To us.
Okay, so everyone good? We're all good? We're all over that? All right. Oh, we got people leaving. Oh, sorry. I'm sorry we had to flick Sonic 06
on you.
Yeah,
they were big Sonic fans. I'm sorry.
Okay, so moving on to our third nominee. The third nominee is our only Nintendo nominee, but we kind of think it deserves a place on this for being the most ambitious cinematic effort they've ever made, and we'll go into further detail why, but you'll probably get it as soon as you see it.
Thank you.
Okay. See, Sonic did have a great moment in the 2000s. All right, so Super Smash Bros. Brawl, the Subspace Emissary, admittedly has a bit of a very bonkers, very confusing storyline, but what works about it when you actually sit back and take it as a whole, I think it's a really great piece of visuals first storytelling, because they don't have any of them talk, and they rely everything to be just communicated through the characters' physical interactions with one another, through very cute and very effective sight gags and physical comedy. I think it's a really, really great moment. And also in terms of just fan service, having them come all together, you see enemies and heroes putting aside their differences for the sake of the Super Smash Brothers universe. It's a really cool, really fulfilling moment. It makes getting through all those platforming levels in Subspace Emissary worth it. I thought it was also kind of funny in rewatching this when we did it that Sakurai's Kirby characters are also the most important ones in this third act moment. They're the ones who have the key to reviving everybody. So putting his boys first, I thought that was cute. And what did you notice when we were watching this the first time?
Amiibos.
The origin of Amiibos. But I really liked it. Is there any BoJack Horseman fans out there? There was a really great episode this season that was 90% dialogue free, and like I was saying with this, it's all about setting up really good visual storytelling. So anytime a creator can do that effectively, it's always awesome. So anything else about Subspace Emissary?
I think you hit everything. They were able to have humor and emotion without speaking a single word of dialogue. So
less is more. Yeah. Okay, so second opinion time. Let's get further back. I like his hat. You like his hat? You wanna? Yeah. Hat. Give me a hand, everybody.
All right. Tell us your name and what you think.
What?
Thank you.
But what's your name?
I'm Stefan.
Very nice to meet you. How you doing?
I'm
here for Stefan.
Yeah.
Merry Christmas!
All right, lay it on us.
Do your worst.
I actually, I played the whole entire Brawl game, and it's been a while since I actually saw the ending cutscene, and that was, pretty good, because I like when characters don't talk, and they just do most of their actions through just wacky little sound effects, or just, doing movements, or just making gestures toward each other. So you can see, okay, that's what we're supposed to look at. I did also like the fact that it was characters coming together, but it first started off as the three wimpy characters that no one really cares for in Brawl.
I love them.
And then they are the ragtag team of people. No one plays Luigi in Brawl. And then as it goes on, it's just the bad guys and the good guys are coming together, especially Link, Zelda, and Ganondorf, the Triforce pack. They come together and they get over the differences, they're something bigger. And then the best part was, out of nowhere, Sonic comes out and just wrecks them. It's all right, it's time for me to do something, even though I've been gone for the whole game.
It's really cool, and I honestly wish, I think I have this right. Sonic and Mario at the Olympic Games came out in 2008, and that was the first time Sonic was in a Nintendo game. I kind of wish they had waited, because it just would have made this on a meta level so much cooler, but it's still a great moment when he shows up.
Oh yeah, it's awesome. I love Sonic, so it's always a good time when he shows up.
Mm-hmm. So, yes, no, does this belong as a nominee?
Oh, sure. It's it has its own, as Nintendo does, it has its own little flavor of taste. It's not just PlayStation action or just Xbox's very gritty story. Just we're going to do a little cute thing, as
All
Nintendo
right.
does.
Good stuff, good stuff. Thank you so much.
Right.
Give him a loud applause.
We got something for you.
Got swag bag time. Okay.
Oh, we got something for you. Here you go.
Yeah.
Swag bag time.
Enjoy.
What do we got? What do we got?
Merry Christmas.
Show everybody.
Assassin's Creed Lineage.
There we go. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
So it's funny he mentioned Xbox telling grim, dark stories, because our final nominee is a grim, dark, depressing story from the Xbox. 2009's Gears of War 2, a payoff to a storyline that was slowly built up over two games. It's an emotional wallop, but it's a really noteworthy cutscene, and we're going to get into that right now.
Jack, open it up. I can't believe it, Marcus. We finally found her. Maria. Maria. I'm so sorry, Maria. I tried to find you. God, I did. Please, no. Maria. God damn it, it's me, Dominic. It's Dominic. Marcus, I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do, man. She...
No. It's okay.
I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. I love you so much.
Alrighty. So, with this selection, what I enjoyed about it is just the nominee, you know. So, Dom's subplot of searching for his lost wife is one of the emotional driving points of the series up until that installment, and it was always really interesting that this series, which kind of deals in a lot of over-the-top macho action game tropes, would put in. You know, just storyline beats for these characters that are that deep and that harrowing. And when you get to it, you don't get the expected, you know, oh, he saves her and it's badass and uplifting. The characters are, for the most part, all at their lowest point. And I think you put it best. It's kind of like their break. It's like a kind of a communal breaking point. You want to like just expand on that because we were talking about it.
Yeah. The during the first two games, really the only thing Dom's living for in that world is to find his wife first and like save the world second. So I feel like after he finds her like that and has to kill her, he pretty much has nothing else to live for. And like from that point on, his character completely changes, and you'll see that in the, like, the third game, where he sacrifices himself to, like, save his buds. But yeah, I don't know. I just think it was a pretty powerful cutscene.
Yeah, when you have the most hopeful character reach his breaking point,
and the fact that, like, when you play it for the first time, you don't know what's happening, and when you see her intact, it kind of builds it up to just kind of take everything away from him, and by extension, you playing through the game. So I don't know. It tugs at your heartstrings. It's really well done, I think, and it shows there can be feels in the macho world of Gears of War.
There you go. There you go. Refrigerators can cry. There you go. All right. Second opinion time. Let's try to get some love to the back.
Who's raising their
hand? Hold on. Who had their hands up in the back? We raise hands. Yes. Okay. There we go.
Excuse me.
No problem. Come on up.
Yeah.
How you doing?
Good. What's your name?
Ryan.
Ryan. Hey, Ryan.
Let's hear it for Ryan.
Hey, Ryan. Round of applause, everybody.
All right. What'd you think?
Well, I do really enjoy the Gears of War 2 series. Like, it's one of the best games out there. This scene for me was a breaking point, but at the same time, I was tired of Dom up to that point anyway.
Oh, okay.
So,
okay.
When I finally made it there and I saw this, I kind of expected it to happen. It is the Gears of War series, after all. Like, I never expected anything hopeful to happen. So for me, this scene, you know, it had a good impact, but it wasn't, like, as powerful as it could be for me. Like, I feel like there are other games that probably could have took its place. Like, even like Midna's Lament from Nintendo series, Mass Effect had some pretty powerful scenes. And even like Fallout series, like if you want to stay out in that realm of things, they had some more powerful scenes where the revelations were way more powerful, where it's like, this is really hopeless. Like, I can't do anything. Like, what can I do? Like, what scope can I actually have on this game? But gotcha. As far as this scene, I would say no.
Okay. Well, thanks very much for sharing your opinion. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Let's give a round of applause. And let's get the swag bag open. We got one last item to give out here.
I think this is the best movies we have.
One and two. One and two. It's both. All right, well, the people have spoken. We've exhausted all of these submissions. So it's down to you. We're going to go one at a time and just be honest with us. You tell us which ones you think, via enthusiasm, deserve to be called the best of the 2000s. Do you think Metal Gear Solid 3, Snake Eater's ending, deserves to be the best? Okay. I got like conditional. Right. That's like a condition. Okay, do you think Warcraft 3, Arthas Kills His Father, deserves to be the best of the decade?
Nah, I don't think so. All right, what about the Nintendo All-Star Amiibo Squad saving the world?
Okay. Gears of War 2?
Well, let's reset. Let's reset that. It's okay.
Okay.
I've been waiting for quiet down.
Yeah, Gears of War 2? All right, well, I don't know.
I think
Gears of War 2 wins. No. Thank you.
So I think we got a pretty clear winner. Hideo Kojima, cutscene master, made the best cutscene of the decade. So Metal Gear Solid 3 Snake Eater is your winner. Clap as if he's here.
And just really quick, just wanted to thank everyone for sticking with us. This is the first time we've done something like this.
Yeah, really appreciate
it.
So
we were really trying to figure out how to do something like this idea with an hour time constraint. So. Mm-hmm. I mean, right now it's like the best we could come up with, and I'm sure a lot of people disagree with what was on the list, but It all came from a pool of what people suggested. So
democracy, yeah. Democracy doesn't work. No.
So
we also want to thank the suggestions that were brought up during the show. We want to do more kind of award showsy things like this, where the audience gets to pick.
Yeah.
So if we're going to keep those examples in mind for the next round of these that we do. So thanks very much. We want to thank you all again for coming out. This has been a lot of fun. We're going to roll the end here. We just want to do some plugging really quick. If you want to see more content like this, we can be found on Twitter. Our handles are up here. Thanks so much to Mewmore and Toonlink for their remixes. And if you want to come up and take a picture for Hideo Kojima when we inevitably find his address and send this to him, we're going to take a nice bigger picture. Thanks a lot, guys. Have a good night. Enjoy MAGFest.
And if anyone...
I'm making a note here. Huge success. It's hard to overstate my satisfaction.
I do want to say something. Please, don't leave. Come back. Come back.
We're going to chase you down.
These are really good friends of mine, and this is the first panel they've done at MAGFest. And I want to memorialize this on video. So if you guys could sit down, and if I could just get a side shot with you guys just cheering for my buddies, that would mean the world to all of us.
Thank you for hot dogging and grandstanding for us.
I'm going to come to the side, we're going to come back, and I'm going to go to the middle. If you guys can just cheer and just give it your all.
You guys are beautiful, thank you. Group photo coming up after this. You want to come up to the stage? Thank you so much for coming out.
Now these points of data make a beautiful line, and we're out of data, we're releasing on time. So I'm glad I got burned. Think of all the things we learned for the people who are still alive.
The first people who get here can stand on stage. Everyone else has to stand at the bottom.
I think I prefer to stay inside.
Keep the middle clear.
Maybe you'll find someone else to help you. Maybe Black Mesa. That was a joke. Ha ha. Bad chance. Anyway, this cake is great. It's so delicious and moist. Look at me still talking.
Anyone who wants to be in a picture that's being mailed to Hideo Kojima at Kojima Productions, please come up here. We're going to take the picture in a few seconds, so we need...
Still alive.
Woo!
It's so quiet.
Yeah.